Welcome. I'm Michelle Anderson of Clarinet Mentors, and today I have a video for you that talks about the different kinds of articulation markings you're going to find in your music. In other words, all the dots and lines and all sorts of things that you're going to see on top of your music, how to interpret them, and how to best play them on the clarinet. Now, this is a fairly basic video. If you're a more advanced player, you likely already know these tricks, but it's very useful for those of you who are just starting out who may not have a great idea on how to interpret these symbols. So I'm going to go through a variety of the most common tonguing styles, and that'll help you when you're playing the music that you're working on at home. So I want to start by looking at just normal tonguing. So in other words, on my sheet here that I'm holding up, the first thing we see is just four quarter notes, regular tonguing. Now I have other videos that really get into the basics of tonguing, but I'll give you the simple version right now. Generally speaking, we want your tongue to hit the reed near the tip. We don't want to go over the top of it, but near the tip, and we want to keep our air blowing all of the time. We all have an instinctive habit to stop our air when our tongue moves, as if we're going tch, tch. But our air should be nonstop, and our tongue will interrupt it. If I were to take an open G, that's the nickname for that note where all the holes in the clarinet are open, and just do normal tonguing, it's the same as if I'm whispering two, 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 two. In fact, I can even speak with my clarinet in my mouth, as weird as that feels. Two, 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 two. The part of my tongue that's now touching the reed, because the reed's in the way of where my tongue usually hits, is basically how we want to do normal tonguing. So you can hear four distinct notes, but my air is blowing one note. Now I have other videos that go into that in more detail, but I'm assuming most of you have the basics for that. All right, our first really common marking in music is called staccato. They're these little dots that appear over the music. Staccato basically means we're going to make those notes extra short, so we're going to hear space after it. Now, there are two common ways of performing staccato on the clarinet, and eventually your goal is to get good at both of those ways. One of those ways is called stop-tonguing staccato. Using that method, our tongue not only starts each note by touching the reed, ta, 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 it comes back to the reed, closes it, stops the vibration, and ends the note. It's as if our tongue does this, ta, ta, ta. Now I'm going to reference another video in the description below here that gives you an exercise that will really help you learn this in detail, because I think it's really useful to learn. Right now, I'm just going to give you a mini description, but I highly encourage you to look at the other video if this is a skill you haven't learned yet. But if I did slow motion staccato, tot, tot, blowing the whole time, you would hear something like this. This is what my tongue is doing. And if I just quickened that process up so my tongue comes off the reed and hurries back, I get a very crisp, short note. Now, normally we wouldn't want to be that short unless it was very fast, but staccato does make the music sound more exciting and more lively, so you're likely to find it in a fast, lively piece. That piece wouldn't be as exciting if my notes were long. It still sounds nice, but it has a little bit of a different energy. So staccato we often associate with fast, lively things. Now, generally speaking, when you see those dots over the note, remind you again what that looks like, my second line here, staccato, an estimate would be that we're just cutting the note in half. So a staccato quarter note is now like a half beat note followed by a half rest. So an eighth note, eighth rest. That gives you a guideline. The other way of doing staccato, and the way that most people naturally fall into, is to simply stop blowing, to sort of go tch, tch, tch. Now, I'll be honest, that's trickier to make sound good on the clarinet. The reason is, for best tone, we want the reed to vibrate back and forth like crazy. And to do that well, it requires really fast, steady airstream. if we're stopping blowing after every single note, it means our air needs to go super fast and strong to nothing, to super fast and strong to nothing. Now, if we could do that instantly, sort of blowing in a fast block and then somehow cut off our air at the source instantly, that would be great. What usually happens though is our air kind of fades. So we end up with great tone and then it kind of fades and we get mushy tone and then we have silence. And then it's kind of hard to start the next note because we've let our air pressure down. For that reason, I do recommend getting very proficient at stop tongue staccato and using that most of the time if you can. It doesn't have to be as crisp as what I was just demonstrating, but it's a handy technique. However, using air staccato is useful, and I'm not going to give a complete lesson on that right now, but I will say that if you are going to stop blowing, you want to get really good at a nice fast burst of air that ends rather quickly. And a great way to practice that is initially without your clarinet, just to pulse little bursts of air. And you can even think about pushing your belly button muscles out when you do that. Now I have other videos, and I'll reference a good video that illustrates this further, that talk about air support and why we would push out with those muscles. So again, check the description, because two videos that go nicely with today's video is the stop tonguing staccato and the air support video. What I might practice, as much as I probably wouldn't perform this way, as a practice exercise, I'll practice huffing into my clarinet just like that. The high register especially, let's say our high G, thumb register key in these three fingers, I might just go just to practice how fast does my air have to be to start a note and then to end it. So without tonguing, I'm just using my breath here. Now at first, you might find if your air is a little wimpy that the notes will kind of fade out or they might not want to speak. You might end up with something like this. That's really common. And this exercise of just huffing usually helps us get a feel for what we'd like to do with our air to make a stop blowing staccato work. Once I feel like I can huff that note pretty well, then I can add my tongue at the start of it. I usually use this stop blowing type of staccato in a piece that is more gentle, and therefore probably the start of the note will be a fairly gentle tongue. It might be a very beautiful, slightly slower piece. That's where I would use that kind of staccato. Nonetheless, you still hear space between the notes, and that's what staccato gives us, is a little bit of silence between the notes. All right, next on our sheet, we have these long lines over the notes. Now this is called tenuto. Sometimes it falls in the category of legato tonguing, which basically means we're stretching the note. And depending on the music, this could have a couple different meanings. Pretty well, it means the note's gonna be long without space. So we're gonna keep our air going and flow right into the next note. Sometimes that line means we're gonna lean on the note just a little bit. So what that might sound like is something like this. So some of those notes, I was just putting on a little bit of an air, da 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 da, and sometimes that staccato line, or sorry, the tenuto line, does mean we lean on it a bit. It's not with our tongue going ta, it's more like we're going na. It's our breath for the most part doing it. Sometimes it's just going to be very, very monotone, very light tonguing. Not much difference from ordinary tonguing, except that perhaps I'm touching the reed a little bit more lightly. So usually when we see that line, we're going to lean on the note just a little bit, not a ta articulation, almost a do, 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 with a little bit of lean with our breath. Next on the list here, this is a very curious articulation marking, and I wish they had invented another way of doing it. Here we have a big slur, and we have staccato. Now the truth is it's not slurred, and it's not staccato. So really they should have invented some completely new symbol, but this is a pretty standard marking in music. The slur is going to indicate that the composer wants a very connected and smooth phrase. The dots indicate that instead of simply slurring, we want a very, very small articulation on the notes. So again, it's not really staccato, it's not really slurring. The way we usually interpret that on clarinet is a very, very light tongue. Now, some people do this by imagining that they're saying the letter L, as if they're going la, 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 and it's almost as though the tongue is hitting the roof of their mouth. For me, personally, that doesn't work so well, but I know for some people they have success with that, so you can experiment with that. What I do, my tongue, position-wise, remains the same as normal tonguing. I have the end of my tongue hitting near the end of the reed. I just endeavor to hit the reed far more lightly than usual. So normal tonguing would have a very distinct ta. This very smooth sort of slur staccato tonguing is the lightest possible touch. If I was just playing an open G, I would think about hitting that reed as lightly as possible. Almost like I'm saying la, la, la. And that takes a little bit of practice. What you'll find is this gives you a very, very smooth effect. Now, sometimes when a composer writes this effect, they're also seeking a little bit of a fade out on each note. Maybe not fully to silence, as regular staccato would do, but a little bit of a fade. And we usually don't play around with notes like this as much on clarinet, but it can be a nice effect. So it's as if our air is going to go. We don't want to accent the start of the note. It's more like we want to fade a little bit once we're in the middle of the note. That's a slightly different effect. And sometimes that's an effect a composer is looking for. Now you have to make that call yourself when you see that marking in the music. Which one would sound better? Complete smoothness with a very gentle start to each note, or a little bit of a fade on each note? And it does depend on the music a little bit. All right, finally, we're going to take a look at the accents that are written in here. I have two different kinds of common accents written on this sheet. You'll see one that's sideways and one that's upright, kind of like an old-fashioned tent. Those are two of the most common accents that we'll find written into our music. And both of those indicate that we're going to start this note with more emphasis. Ta, there's going to be some strength there. To get that effect, our tongue can actually hit the reed a little more forcefully than usual. So normal tonguing, I would think of ta. This one, I'm going to think ta. Just like hitting a drum harder will give you a more accented start to the note. Now a little bit, sometimes our air can also give a little bit of pulse at the beginning of that note to give us this effect. I hit that note with some force. Now you may be wondering what the difference is between the sideways one and the upright one, because we see both of them quite a bit in our music. Well, the difference is the length of the note. The sideways accent has no impact on the length of the note. We just start the note with that kind of accented, strong beginning. The upright accents indicate that we're going to make that note short. It's virtually the same as staccato. So what I've written here, sideways, upright, that would indicate long, short. Ta, tut, ta, tut. Or if I played that on an open G, just so you can hear how I might interpret it on clarinet, they're going to start virtually the same way, but the ends of the notes are different. All of them I'm starting with a little more emphasis than I normally would. That basically sums up how you would do those accents. Sometimes there's other markings you might see in the music. Often with these upright accents, we'll see what's called a sforzando, and that's abbreviated SFZ if you're in Canada or England, SFZ for many other parts of the world. A sforzando is kind of like an extra strong accent, so that's a pretty common marking that you're going to find as well. But this gives you an overview of many of the most common articulation markings. They're useful to know, and they really do enhance the music by adding some variety and emphasis to the notes. If you've enjoyed today's video, I would love to hear from you. There's a comments box right below it. Fill in your questions, your comments. I go into YouTube about twice a week, and I really look forward to hearing from you, and I'll answer any questions that you have. I also have an invitation for you. If you like the clarinet and you like learning about things, I invite you to join, absolutely free, my Clarinet Mentors community. You go to www.learnclarinetnow.com and you'll see a sign up form. And when you join the community, you'll get a newsletter from me about every 2 weeks. Each newsletter will have an educational video, just like the one you just watched. And not only that, I'll give you all of my recommendations on my favorite clarinet stuff. I'm always looking for great new clarinet music and gadgets and reeds and performers and special events. And I want you to be aware of those things because I think they might interest you as well. I also, from time to time, host special clarinet events that I only can tell people who are in the community about. So I really invite you to join up. If it's not a good fit for you, you can unjoin at any time very, very easily. So I'd love to see you there. Thank you again for watching today's Clarinet Mentors video, and I look forward to seeing you on future videos.